and then show so they can see.
Perfect. On, press hard, and it's on, right?
Until you see the little light. There you go. Now it's on.
Now turn it off.
You press it. You press it and leave it on, and it'll turn on.
Seems okay.
I won't leave unless you say it's all right.
You'll have to ask Dr. Irving.
I'm saying I'm not going to leave until she's comfortable with how everything's working.
Do we get started? That would be fine. Yeah, nice. Absolutely. Thank you.
Well, what is it you're presenting, if you don't mind my asking?
It's a book about American women in World War One.
Oh.
It's a good topic.
I'm prior military, and I'm a strong proponent of females in the military.
Interesting.
I've met quite a very remarkable women in there.
Well, they were really screwed over in World War One. Let me tell you, they didn't. The women who were in were telephone operators. They got Signal Corps uniforms. They were sworn in, and then they were found out they were civilian employees and denied all benefits.
Oh, geez.
It wasn't corrected until the feminist movement took over in the 70s and started agitating, and they finally got...
thank goodness.
Yeah. So, anyway. Yeah, so well, it's been a long struggle.
Well, even when I was in, it wasn't easy for them.
Right? Yeah.
They weren't considered equals.
Yeah, well.
But from what I read, 1st Infantry...
To which?
Yeah.
There?
Yeah.
Outreach Committee, I welcome all of you with this year's Rondo Davidson Lecture. This series is named after our late colleague, Dr. Rondo Davidson, who specialized in British history. Shortly after his passing, Dr. Davidson's family began raising the endowment that has allowed us to bring a distinguished speaker here each year, and we, of course, welcome all of them. Before I turn you over to Dr. Gooding, I'd like to acknowledge a few of the folks who helped make this year's event possible. Maestra Avila over here has taken care of a lot of the detailed work in getting tonight's reception ready, and for that, we are most grateful to her. I also would like to Visual and Information Technology Department for making our first YouTube recording. We made sure that the microphone was resuscitated and brought back to vigorous life. Thank you both. You have saved us the trouble of saying, could anybody please come down and bunch up together so you can hear us? That's very good. And of course, saving the best for last, Mrs. Davidson, welcome. Would you please stand up and take a bow? And with that, I need to move on to our guest speaker. We are very happy to have tonight Dr. Lynn Jumanil. She has had a career of more than Dental College in Los Angeles. She is the author of 4 books, all of them well-regarded, including The Women's History of the United States. On the screen, you see the latest book that she has published, The Second Line of Defense, American Women and World War I. And as an ongoing tribute to her fine energy and continued dedication to the profession, let me note that she is currently working on 2 more books. So, I will have the honor this evening of acting as the button pusher and clicker for her slides. And with that said, I will turn you over to her.
Thank you. Good evening. Thank you for coming. It's an extraordinary honor to be here as the Rundell Davidson lecturer. By her husband, that actually coincided with my high school history term paper. So it's a nice little kismet of beginning of my career and towards the latter part of my career. I also want to thank the History Department for being such gracious hosts. I've had a terrific time talking to them, and particularly to Dr. Levinson for his work in hosting me and taking care of me and making sure that everything worked well. So I'm really, again, very pleased to be here. Now I'm going to turn on my timer so that I know that I'm well behaved. And before I talk about women in World War I, I want to just make a broad comment about women and U.S. history as fields. Women's history in the United States really got started in the 1970s, and it was kind of celebratory, talking about how great women were and we should uncover all this past. It tended to focus on white women, elite women, and then a more sophisticated it became far more inclusive, looking at race, ethnicity, and class, and also the divisions among women, not just all sisterhood is powerful type of thing. And also what happened is that the field of U.S. history started to integrate women, the broad story, the narrative. So it starts appearing in women's history textbooks, not as a sidebar, but as a part of the integral to the story of the U.S. History. So it's a richer narrative for being more inclusive, but it also broadened our scope of what questions we ask as historians. So for example, political history is more than elections and politicians and government policy. It's also the exercise of political influence. And women were pioneers in interest group lobbying. That meant because they didn't have the vote, right? And so by looking at women in the political arena, we learn a lot more about grassroots activism, about lobbying and the like. So women and war, that seems a sort of odd juxtaposition because masculinity is so closely tied up with definitions of war and what it means to be a citizen, to sacrifice, you know, the ultimate sacrifice as a male soldier. So why study women and war? Well, partly it's because in modern wars like World War I and World War II, civilians play a crucial role. Civilians, including women, and this is for all the combatant nations, women worked in munitions factories, they served as nurses and other aides to the military machine. This process was far more bureaucratic than it had been in the past. It was part of the nation state as it's developing this sort of modern warfare. And national leaders turned to voluntary associations, especially those of middle class and elite women, to disseminate propaganda, to raise funds, to conserve food and material. And this was particularly true in the United States. Thus, the ways in which American women supported the war effort were actually part of the definition of how a modern global war is fought. So in looking at, thinking about the ways in which women's history helps us to understand a broader sense of it, looking at women in war certainly expands our understanding of the process of mobilizing for war. But the other thing that we can do with in this context with women's history is to think about the role of World War I on the home front as a watershed. I found when I was writing my book on the 1920s that Americans talked about change that they were experiencing in their own lives in the 20s since the war. It became a marker, a kind of way of understanding and explaining the transformations they were experiencing. And this was particularly the case for talking about what was going on with women shortly after World War I. Americans discovered or rediscovered what they called the new woman. She was seemingly liberated in terms of politics, work, and private life, especially sexually. Of course, this new woman was a stereotype. The flapper was really meant to describe white, young, privileged women. And it's also doubtful that many women were as liberated as contemporaries seem to think. But there's no question that among mainstream women, new norms and new opportunities were emerging. And observers during the 20s often gave the war at least partial credit for the new woman. After the war, according to popular writer Frederick Lewis Allen, women, quote, poured out of schools and colleges into all manners of occupations, causing, he said, the slackening of husbandly and parental authority and creating a headlong pursuit of freedom. Well, admittedly, during World War I, dramatic changes did seem imminent. Militant women suffrage supporters were outraging the nation by picketing the White House. Women were taking jobs formerly thought to be exclusively men's. 25,000 served overseas as supports for the troops. Millions did highly visible volunteer work at home. But was the war really transformative? Journalists noted that the nation had struck sex, S-E-X, a clock, to refer to the changes in sexual morality that seemed to be participants starting in 1910, before the war. The teens were also extremely important in terms of women and politics. The progressive men's, as I said earlier, for a consciousness concerning the emergence of the new woman. I argue that these changes were underway before the war, but we can use the war as a magnifying glass to see them sort of writ large in such a dramatic moment in Americans' history. Now, my book examines a wide range of issues, much broader than I can talk about here. Women's war work, women's experiences in the workforce, the suffrage movement and war, and the differences of experiences across class, race, and ethnicity, which are an important part of the book, but not what I'm going to talk about tonight. Today, I want to hone in on this question about the war as a marker of change. And I'm going to do that by looking at visual imagery. Americans were bombarded with pictures and films that depicted women in a variety of ways. Now, in mainstream popular culture of the era, women of color were virtually invisible in the reporting about what was going on during World War I. That doesn't mean they weren't there, of course. In Los Angeles, for example, Mexican-American, Japanese-American, and African-American women were active in Red Cross auxiliaries, segregated ones, that raised funds and provided knitted goods for the troops. And so there's some activity, but the historical record is extremely thin. Another thing that's important about the war that historians have managed to do a good job of talking about is the impact of the Great Migration. African Americans came in from the South to the cities of the North and these included many women, who found enormously exciting opportunities beyond domestic and agricultural labor as they got jobs working in defense-related industries. But although we can find evidence of their participation, especially that of black women, the modern woman so celebrated during the war and after was in fact defined in part by her whiteness. So I'm going to turn to these images of white women, both in print and film, and talk about the way, and hope to convince you that these images had a lot to do with the perceptions about the modern woman. You can give me the first slide. Okay, good. Government propaganda, for the most part, followed a very conventional pattern. Posters frequently use female figures as abstract icons representing the nation and its war aims. A beautiful woman flanked by the United States flag, or sometimes even dressed in the stars and stripes, symbolized why the nation was fighting and often was explicitly used to encourage men to enlist. And I think you can see the sort of quality of the heroic female icon here. It reveals the way in which wartime illustrators conflated and idealized woman with the nation state. These were heroic figures, not real women, whose iconography was rooted in Western European art and religious conventions. Now, and I'm going to get the next slide, please. This one I particularly like. I didn't find it, another historian did. This was in a fairly obscure magazine directed towards African-American women. So it's not seen very broadly, but nonetheless, it's so interesting because the African-American press wanted their own posters featuring an African-American Lady Liberty. And so that's what they've done. And if you can, I don't know if you can see below, it's Made in America, M-A-I-D. And the editors commented on the multiple puns. Made meaning African-Americans are often domestic workers, made meaning a young woman, and made, M-A-D-E, meaning that they were real Americans. And so African Americans try to participate in this process, but it's really invisible to the mainstream. Now, even when posters represented actual women and encouraged them to participate in war activities like farming in the Women's Land Army, or buying Liberty Bonds, or knitting socks for soldiers, or conserving food, in all of these cases, the government images rarely challenged ideas of women's proper place. Food conservation posters, if you could give me the next one, please. Food conservation posters featured charming housewives in the kitchen, like the woman on the left, the grandmotherly woman in the center, again, a sort of maternal, a deeply maternal figure, and even the nurse, who one could argue has a certain amount of power in that, a very conventional notion. Poster. That's good. No, I was right. So the one on the left is not a government poster. It's a YWCA. Look at this. This is quite extraordinary. These women are dressed in masculine style clothing, some of them wearing pants. They're in a horde, they're marching, and they're carrying sledgehammers and wrenches, right? So that's the YWCA, which is, views itself as a supporter of working women. The picture on the right, however, is the U.S. government's notion of the way in which working women might contribute to the war. And although it gives them a role, certainly, it's in a very conventional way as a clerical worker. And so that's the sort of point I'm trying to make here, that there's a real tension between the ways in which women's activities in the war are represented visually during the war. Now, like government propaganda, commercial media usually portrayed women in traditional roles. There were poignant descriptions or depictions of soldiers leaving their women folk behind as they went off to war. Romantic pictures of soldiers and their sweethearts were equally compelling. Next one, please. This is, I'm hitting the trail to Normandy, so kiss me goodbye. The man and the woman locked in a passionate embrace was a little bit more erotic than most of these images, but nonetheless emphasized that war is men's work. She's staying home, he's going off. It's framing men's military service, not just in terms of defending their country, but of also protecting female dependents. Okay. And they appear, and they're donuts on the firing line in the Red Cross Emergency Hospital, where she is omnipresent. So the media gets very fascinated by this idea of women's activism, of their challenging these boundaries, and in particular when they took on men's jobs, jobs that have been formerly exclusively open to male workers. Now, I should point out that the number of women working during World War I didn't really grow that much. It was that they had access to different jobs, jobs that usually paid better, had more status, and were more satisfying. Jobs, not for housewives to come and take new jobs, all right? It's really a... This is the Philadelphia Inquirer. Would you give me the next one, please? This is one of my favorite. New Jersey women, they were munitions workers. They were called powder makers. The women are dressed in identical overalls and little caps. Their arms are around each other. They look boldly into the camera. They seem to be having a great time, if not in their work, certainly in having their pictures taken. And the very nature of the group photograph like this seems to reinforce a sense of shared identity among the women as the much-touted munitions workers. And the newspaper praised them in print as well as in the image. It said the girls employed here have shown that they are not afraid of their jobs as powder makers, but go to their work with the same coolness as the men. And these images multiply. A photograph of 9 New York City women dressed in conductor uniforms. Like the munitions worker features this group picture of smiling, confident women. An Iowa newspaper offered a photograph of a pants-wearing munitions worker standing at a formidable-looking machine and explained that women working at the Frankfurt federal government had taken them up on it and became the sort of regular uniform that munitions workers working for the federal government used. So let me turn to this question about clothing, because I think it's pretty important. It really, the notion of women wearing clothes that approximated men's clothing really underscores the novelty of women taking on what were formerly men's jobs. Before the war, working women's costumes usually consisted of a black skirt and a simple dark skirt and a white shirt, much like the typists that you saw earlier. And this would persist in the war years for most women, although the skirts got a little bit shorter. But the women whose new jobs required pants or overalls or skirted uniforms broke dramatically with convention. Their masculinized clothing symbolized the way in which they were taking on male jobs. And women who wore uniforms, especially conductors and elevator operators and the like, were notable in that their apparel was linked to a military uniform. The uniforms not only suggested that women were moving across workplace boundaries, but also symbolized that it was part of their service to the nation in a time of war. They were thus, the uniforms became an expression of citizenship. And this cross-dressing worker that was so prevalent in imagery at the time really signaled, I think, this boundary-crossing new woman. And it's not just women working in factories. It's also women who served abroad as nurses or social workers or telephone operators, or those who volunteered at home for governmental or quasi-governmental agencies because they received extensive publicity that featured their uniforms. The next one, please. Oh, that's not it. Never mind. Stay there. I don't have the one I thought I had. Sorry. This is an image, actually, of a canteen worker. She's serving the troops abroad, and it's very typical. You don't see her uniform as clearly in this particular image, but you do see that sort of confident young woman who really seems to symbolize a lot of the sort of modern quality that people are so interested in. The next slide is another YWCA slide, and this really makes an excellent point, I think, about the women who are abroad. This is a Signal Corps telephone operator. Telephone operators were crucial to the process of the war. And in this case, they're portraying the operator in her neat uniform, very competently at work at her switchboard. But behind her, the battle scenes are just extraordinary. And there she is at one, I would argue, with the uniformed men in battle. Like the men, she is at the front. And her uniform really underlines that quality. And finally, I should just say that people who were at home doing volunteer work were wearing uniforms like crazy. Red Cross women, members of the Women's Council of National Defense, which was a mobilization agency, Red Cross workers, Liberty Loan marchers, all of them are engaged in war work and they're wearing uniforms to do it. Next slide, please. That's the one that I thought I had earlier. So you can see this is the kind of thing that appeared all the time in magazines and newspapers, showing all the different kinds of uniforms that volunteer women might be wearing. So it was a really, really big deal. Now, their activities in doing all this, of wage earners, of overseas participants, of the home front volunteers, received their clearest expression, I think, of citizenship and boundary crossing in the way in which magazines and newspapers covered parades, especially the Liberty Loan parades and the Red Cross ones. These two emphasized the uniform woman. Now, just a few years before World War I, it was considered very radical and subversive for women to march in public. The suffrage movement began its parades in 1910, taking to the streets in a forceful challenge to notions of respectability. And this was so disreputable that actually women who participated in the suffrage march after Wilson's inauguration were set upon by thugs, and the police didn't do anything about it. So it's a really, really still pretty subversive thing as late as 1916, specifically Pennsylvania Avenue, right? So what happens during World War I is all to be marching in the streets. So this, there you go. This public space and the proper films are extended. And magazines, stills, and about 7 movies and a few serials that still exist. So I feel like I got a focus on war and the home front and domestic issues. And these are interesting, some of them at least, because they represent war as a means for men. So the drama going on in the film is about men protecting women. I turn on the theme. A lot of themes of rape and assault, which are quite startling unless you are steeped in the history of the era. I want to backtrack a little bit by looking at a few posters. Next slide. For contemporary viewers, the first one on the left, would evoke the brutal deaths of children and the rapes of women that were the subjects of extensive British propaganda. This propaganda was undoubtedly exaggerated, though certainly wartime rapes did take place. And there's no doubt that the American public's perception of German soldiers was of brutal Huns. And so here you are. Its power derives in part from the pervasive American convention of racial others, both blacks and immigrants, as threats to pure white womanhood. And for the last one, we have to dig a little bit. The woman's form across Uncle Sam's lap is an iconic representation of the United States, a device that I've already talked about, right? Here we are supposed to connect the concept with the nation's honor. This still extant, you can see it. It came out in 1918, it's a D.W. Griffith film. It centers two young Americans, Marie and Douglas, fall in love. Their wedding plans are sort of disrupted by, the war. And the American decides to fight for France. The film details the Huns' degradation of the villagers. The young women of the village are sexually assaulted by drunken Germans. Marie Field, next slide, please. Which you can see quite dramatically on the left in the film. Convention. As they await their inevitable capture, Marie asks Douglas to swear that he will kill her himself if the Germans break through, thus rescuing her from a fate literally worse than death. And at the Germans as they're coming up the steps. It happens to be a woman character who's very spunky. Okay, so this rape threat, and it's extensive in the films of the era, This rape threat owes a lot to the conventions of melodrama in the theater, certainly. And if you've seen the sort of notorious Birth of the Nation, the racist depiction of post-Reconstruction U.S., you'll remember that a rape of a black men of white women is a theme throughout that. And so the audiences seeing these films were kind of primed for this interpretation, right? So the war uses these at stake at the war. Brutality against vulnerable women. And they presented also women as vulnerable, easily victimized, and that in turn re-inscribes a kind of Victorian notion of women's sexual passivity. And that also served as a vehicle for reinforcing Victorian notions of ascendancy and letting their sons be dominated by women. There's also women in these slacker films. Here they sort of they emphasize the dangerous side of maternal love. There are at least a dozen of these films. My favorite, which I didn't see, I've read the script and went to distribute. So let me show you the stills. Next slide, please. Actually forces a true man to become and man, and they not only strength here, some plucky women, but the plucky women really appear in the spy films. So I want to move to that. This is really a pretty fun group of films that feature young women who show great bravery in the face of danger. In many cases, they cross-dress. They wear men's clothes, at least for part of the film. And they, in the brave women, in this, even the cross-dressing ones were not new to the war effort, because you could see this in serial films, which were popular in the teens. It ran, you know, every, like soap operas every week. They were mostly aimed then at working class women who featured heroines who acted in unconventional ways, courting and escaping danger, showing pluck and daring do. The most significant serial to deal with this was one called Patria, which came out in 1916 and 17. Much of it's lost, but because they were serialized in the newspaper, you can follow it with illustrations and the like. Patria was interesting to film historians for many years because it was created by William Randolph Hearst's company, and he was very much influenced by it, and he also, it rejected his politics. He not only called for preparedness, for arming for war, but he also, the film also features not Germany as America's enemy, but Mexico and Japan, really showing the sort of racism that motivated Hearst. So I want to focus here, because that part's been studied pretty well, but I want to focus on the representation of the heroine Patria, who was played by a really famous star, Irene Castle. Week after week, Patria and Parr, her government agent boyfriend, face one horrific threat after another. Patria proves herself to be a crack shot, an ace pilot, and a fearless defender of herself and others. One reviewer's breathless comment is worth reporting at length. In this case, the reviewer is describing Castle because reviewers sort of assume that the actresses were really doing their own stunts, okay? So I'm gonna read the whole thing. It's sort of breathless, but I'll try to convey it. In Patria, she is thrown from the back of a galloping horse. She dives headlong from the deck of an ocean-going steamship and swims to a motorboat into which she climbs unassisted. She climbs the mast of a burning ship with the flames licking the shrouds and falls with the mast into the water far below. She plunges over a waterfall into the whirlpool. She races her motor against a railway car loaded with dynamite. She flies an airplane. She operates a machine gun and does many other things that make you gasp. But never for a moment does she lose her dainty, graceful, feminine charm. I don't think that was all in one, 15-minute episode. So this emphasis on castles and by extension Patria's femininity is pervasive in the serialized version of the plot, as well as in reviews and advertisements. They emphasize particularly her gorgeous clothing, including an elegantly tailored skirted military uniform. Next slide. Oh, we have it. There it is. Good. This image shows her in full military garb with her arms outstretched, her body sort of leaning forward. And I think it should convey some of the feminine power that the serial sought to impress. She's confident and she's independent. Now, as something of a side note, besides depicting strong womanhood, the serial did offer scenes of sexual danger, similar to what I was talking about earlier. Patria's childhood friend, Bess, was captured by Mexican spies and taken to Mexico. Patria is distraught because she knows, quote, the fate of women kidnapped across the border. Bess is rescued, and this particular plotline disappears. But in the series, Patria herself faces unwanted advances, always by men of color. In one instance, it's a Japanese man, and another, it's a Mexican man who seeks to kiss her. In both cases, she brings out a pistol and fends them off. These are minor pieces of the serial, but I think they're notable because the offenders are men of color and thus merge perfectly with the trend in popular culture popular culture conventions. It emerges incidentally, but it's significant. It reinforces the message of Patria symbolizing the young, white, American new woman. I won't leave you hanging, you know, for the next installment. It does end. Mexico and Japan do invade across the border. Patria's boyfriend who's in charge is wounded, so she has to take over again, and naturally she manages to rout the invasion. Not only is the invasion repelled, but at the end they commit themselves to each other and to the service of their country. So that's our serial for the plucky women. And it also appears in a lot of feature films as well, where you keep finding these really brave women doing all sorts of amazing things, facing down villains, foiling spy plots, and the like. The two films that I want to talk about that are feature films feature Mary Pickford. Both of them are available, so you can see them if you wish. Pickford was already a major star in the teens. She was loved for her curls and her winsome performance, in which she invariably played young girls, not women. But in her two war-related films, she plays adults. In Johanna and Lys, which came out in 1918, she's a lonely girl stuck on a farm, bored with the tedium of rural life and farm chores, and frustrated with really strict parents, all of which is portrayed for laughs. Her boredom evaporates when a military unit camps on her father's land. At that point, she falls in love with an impressive army officer. There's a lot more comedy and, you know, missed signals in that process. The film ends with Johanna stealing a small soldier's uniform and putting it on in order to escape with her fiancé as he decamps for war. She's found, she's discovered, but the colonel says, oh no, she can become a mascot for us. So the film ends with her still dressed in the uniform on a cannon wagon going off to war, presumably, with her husband carrying her boyfriend carrying the American flag. Well, the film is interesting on several counts, including, of course, the dress sweat, the cross-dressing that seems to suggest Johanna's frustration with her limited sphere on the farm, or perhaps as a woman. But such an outfit worn by Pickford was never meant to be signaling conventional masculine strengths associated with the military uniform. Next slide. And you can see this, I think, quite clearly in both of these images. She's still as feminine, as adorable as she ever was. She's not very threatening here because she's wearing a uniform. A number of scholars have noted that cross-dressing used for comedic effect often serves to draw attention to gender differences rather than challenge them. And you can see that, I think, in the next slide, which are two really popular and well-known propaganda posters for enlistment, in which men are being pushed to enlist so that they can attract the sexy young the sexy young women. So there are limits to Joanna being a new woman. She transgresses boundaries, but her liberation is really constrained by her femininity and her romantic desire. But the film is also closely tied to Pickford's real-life persona. She was definitely a modern woman, especially in her war activities. She adopted the 143rd Field Artillery Unit in California, and in fact, they serve as extras in the film. She does a lot of fundraising during the war, offering rousing orations, encouraging men to enlist and women to urge their men to enlist. She attracted thousands of spectators and certainly became the most well-known female supporter of the war effort. There's no reason to think that this was all a publicity ploy, but certainly her studio made the most of it when they publicized her pictures. In the final film, I want to talk about The Little American. One of the film's posters transforms Mary into an iconic American figure. Next slide, please. Are we done?
No, we're not. Oh. I just fumbled the control.
There you go. So it's just like the posters we saw earlier, only it's now America's sweetheart. America and Mary are one in this film. Now this film, which came out right before the United States entered the war, is pretty fascinating. Here she plays an adult woman, and there's a really interesting correspondence between DeMille and his producer, because the producer very specifically said that he wanted Pickford to, quote, portray a girl in the sort of role that the feminists of the country are now interested in, the kind of girl who jumps in and does a man's work when the men are at the front. Well, she doesn't quite do that, but she is, pretty competent, confident. Before the war, Angela Moore is in Washington, D.C., and she has two boyfriends. One's French, one's German. The war comes, they have to go back. Meanwhile, Angela, who's a neutral American, discovers that her aunt in Belgium is ill and she must go to help her. So she gets on a boat, and of course it's torpedoed, and this film is an extraordinary recreation of the Lusitania, basically. In the rescue boat, we get the first hint of Angela's spunkiness. She shakes her fist at the submarine commanders and chastises them. Holding up the flag, she exclaims, "You've fired on American women and children. Shame." By the time she reaches the chateau, her aunt has died and the Germans are fast approaching. Her first goal becomes to protect her women servants. Next slide, please. You see a nice image of that from a still on the left. She's protecting them from the marauding Germans who are going to take over her villa. They are. Meanwhile, she has to face them herself alone. They're brutes who threaten her. When a new soldier appears, who of course turns out to be her former boyfriend, Carl, in the dark, he almost rapes her. Once they recognize each other, she chastises him for having become part of the military machine. And together they hear the off-screen scream of a raped servant. Angela says to Carl, "If there's a spark of manhood left in you, go and save these young women." Through a complex set of developments, Angela ends up spying for the French, encouraged by her other boyfriend, the French guy who shows up at the same place. And then Carl redeems himself and tries to save her from being caught as a spy. Both get arrested. They're in front of a firing squad. They're afraid. They're saved by the arrival of the French, only there's a bomb which wipes them out and almost kills everyone, but Mary's the one who saves the German, Jules, her boyfriend. And in the film ends with him in a POW camp, and because of her service to France, he's going to be released to her care, and they're going to go to the U.S. This is before the U.S. enters the war, obviously. But nonetheless, it's quite an extraordinary thing about Mary's role. She's not simply the star, she's the heroine, who is resolute in her determination to do what's right. She emerges as an independent, plucky American woman, certainly there's an emphasis on that, who thinks nothing of going to Belgium alone in the midst of war, and when she becomes entangled in the war, is resourceful and brave in saving both herself and the man she loves. The plucky heroine like Angela signaled challenges to conventional notions about a woman's essentially passive role in war. They save themselves and others. They become orators. They serve as nurses abroad. More dramatically, movie heroines like Irene Castle's Patria or Pickford's Angela challenge barriers to notions of women's conventional and respectable behavior by taking on the enemy firsthand and winning. The radical potential of this challenge, however, was constrained, I would argue, by the emphasis on femininity and the predictable happy ending of love and marriage. And I also think the persistent motif of sexual danger remained a potent reminder of women's vulnerability. Films then hint at a provocative new woman enjoying new freedoms and independence, but ultimately convey the limits of wartime opportunities for significant change in women's roles. So to conclude, in World War I, print and film media had conventional images of women, especially those that featured their sexual vulnerability, but these coexisted with more modern representations. The juxtaposition of the two suggests the way in which the era was suffused with tensions about the changing role of American women, tensions that predated the war. Clearly, the media recognized and provocatively pictured the potential for dramatic change in women's lives. Working women challenged men's prerogatives, never more obviously than when they donned overalls and uniforms. Parading women who took their patriotism to the streets also suggested that many women were eager to move beyond the constraints of home and family to a larger arena. Many film heroines were resourceful, independent, and brave. American audiences were relentlessly exposed to women who challenged conventions in work, in clothing, in freedom of movement, in the occupation of physical space. So much so that many were convinced that the war had produced dramatic change. That's where I started. But although these representations hinted at possibilities for female agency and power, most did not survive the war. The war expedited but did not cause the passage of the Woman Suffrage Amendment. And despite its importance, it did not significantly enlarge women's political power. Women workers in the 1920s continued in the workforce but were limited to devalued women's work for the most part. Let's contrast the image of the war's new women and the 20s new women. Next slide, please. So here we have Patria on the one hand and the way in which the US Postal Service has represented the flapper. And then in the next image, we have our young modern women in the slacker film. And for those of you who don't know, that's the It Girl. So filled with sexuality. So the new woman of the war years wasn't portrayed in a sexualized manner, obviously. But perhaps the physical freedom, the challenges to notion of respectable behavior offer us at least one clue to the 1920s new woman. If the war did not bring political or economic power, maybe Frederick Lewis Allen, I hate to say this, but maybe he was right in that it promoted a slackening of husbandly and parental authority that affected women in their private, not their public lives. Thank you. I'm happy to take questions or comments. Yes, hi.
Hi, thank you for that wonderful talk. I absolutely love your topic. And I'm really interested in this juxtaposition of kind of this patriotic daring of white women and in turn their feminine daintiness, I think is the word that you use. And I think this is not altogether new. We see this all the time in scenarios of war. And I think you started out your talk by talking about how there's an absence of representations of women of color.
Yes.
The imagery is almost always exclusively representing white women. So what I want to know, or what I want you to kind of think through with me is, so what degree is the ability of white women to transgress against conventional gender norms, as in domesticity and daintiness, yet still maintain this femininity and this supposed and supposedly not challenge the idea of white womanhood as proper and ideal. So I want to know kind of what your thoughts are on that, and if that idea would in turn allow us to talk about racial inequality using those images.
That's a multi-part question. Is that all right? We're good. One of the things that I want to talk about a little bit is about the notion of how they promote they continue to be dainty and feminine. A number of people have argued that when the suffrage activists start marching, they are determined to be very neatly dressed, and even though they're doing something transgressive, to emphasize femininity. So there's not a willingness to say, oh, we're all going to look like those women in the YWCA posters who are wearing men's suits and look like they're from a Russian realist propaganda poster. So that's one thing. There's just a lot of complexity that's going on here, generally. And I think that you're right, that there's something about this sort of question of what all this particularly might mean for women of color, because although Africa, I didn't talk about this, but I have a long section about African-American women engaged in protests against racial violence during World War I. And one of the things they do is march in a parade down Fifth Avenue, which was, again, completely novel for them to do. And so they're taking to the streets as well, certainly. And the other thing that they do when they talk about racial violence is they talk about the violation of black women, right? So there's a lot of discussion within the black community about these kinds of issues. Everyone's worried about that problem. This is the real problem, right? And so I would think that there's absolutely a connection between the sort of glorification of white womanhood and the devaluation of black womanhood. And black women are very aware of it, and they write about it in certainly in veiled ways. But they don't. Black women, to my knowledge, aren't willing to sort of challenge in public ways, like wearing pants and things like that, the way that white women were. And I think it wasn't safe. It didn't feel safe. Does that speak to some of your questions? It's a very good question. Thank you. Yes. Hi. I didn't hear the last part. If that happened,
did it reflect in America?
I see. Good question. So the question, if you didn't hear, was what about the allies and what was going on with women there, and did that affect what was going on in the United States? It's kind of complicated because there were different allies. The French tended to be the most conservative about what they would let women to do. They were a little nervous about it. The Germans and the British engaged women a little bit more dramatically, especially the British. But it was a hard-fought battle. There's an enormous amount of discrimination and hostility towards women, even though they're being honored for being so brave, being ambulance drivers, for example. The British women were allowed to be close to combat. They were allowed to be ambulance drivers. The American women were not. They were really kept from the front as much as possible, but some of them sneak in anyway. So there's differences among them, but it does reflect that the nations, as they're trying to mobilize for war, need this sort of expanded force of people to serve the troops in various kinds of ways. And at one point, there was this discussion about needing clerical help in France, but the military didn't want to bring American women, so there was they hired British women. Right, so not to expose too many American women to danger. Does that answer your question? That was a good one. Thank you. Yes.
It's like reality and movies, which are two different things.
Of course.
Right? But a great majority of the war movies to promote the war and to promote encouragement for the war were by Jewish people. So were these away from the Jewish film producers?
That's a good question. Where the films in
the
so where do where
just
which?
Back up like one step.
But I want to be close. The question is, the role of the Jewish filmmakers in the film industry is what you're talking about, right? And there's certainly a lot of emphasis on showing patriotism on the part of Jewish immigrant filmmakers to sort of legitimate themselves. And so you see that. I'm embarrassed. I don't know for sure the answer to your question. I know that women wrote a number of the films that I'm talking about. And DeMille certainly was not part of that crowd, but I don't know the answer. You've stumped me, but it's a good question. Yes. Yes, that's you, certainly. I need to speak a little bit louder. I'm having a little trouble understanding you because I'm older.
The way you portray the African, how you talk about the African American women.
Yes.
Is that share with everybody else, like other minorities, or is that just specific for African American women?
Okay, so that question I can answer pretty clearly. There's very little material on other women, minority women, other than African Americans. African Americans are well organized, they're in organizations, they have magazines, they write stuff. So historians can get pretty deep. For experiences of Mexican American women or women who, Tejanas, or Japanese American women, it's just we don't know very much. That's the problem. So I can't answer your question. But I don't mean to suggest they were all the same, but we really don't know very much about the other group, except they're invisible to the public. Okay, question two. So, say again, one more time, sorry.
At that time, there was this ideology of romanticism of World War.
Yes.
So, does that play a role in how women are being portrayed, or is there something that happens?
That's a really good question. So, as many of you probably know, at least at the beginning of war, and this is certainly the case in England, there's a kind of romanticization of war. Men are going to go and prove their manhood. And so is this a continuation of that, that it sort of feeds into protecting our women and children? I think you're absolutely right. I think there's a real link between that, romanticization. Good question. Thank you. You had a question before, didn't you, over here? No? Where did I get my primary sources? Primary sources were from at film archives. I got to go to MoMA and see a little tiny clip of Patria, which was incredibly cool because I didn't have to pay admission, or wait in line. There are a lot of really good archives for film. And then newspapers and magazines. Some of you who are interested in, who are writing history projects and things like that, now there are amazing newspaper databases, just extraordinary, so that you can plug in women parades and Liberty loans and get 1,000 hits and find out, which images are available. Now there's a lot more also of African American newspapers. They're not well illustrated, unfortunately, but there are a lot of articles which I was able to use as well. Yes?
Did the pacifist women, such as the mothers, did they feel any backlash from the active women?
Did the mothers...
like the pacifist women.
Oh, pacifist.
Yes, like the moms. They were overbearing or whatnot. Did they feel any backlash from the active women?
That's a really good question. Someone's written some really wonderful stuff on this. I'm kind of stealing from Susan Ziegler. It's not my work. But she pointed out that there was an enormous amount of anxiety as the United States is gearing up for war about the power of the pacifist movement, the feminists who are really working, mostly not feminists, but pacifists, many of whom are women, including highly prestigious ones like Jane Addams, who was the head of the American Women's Peace Movement. Okay, so they're powerful. Adams went to the White House 6 times as the lead up to the war because Wilson invited her to the White House. So there's a lot of power there. And so there's some concern that with all of this support, including support within the suffrage movement for the pacifist movement, that it's going to be hard to mobilize. This isn't a universally popular war. And so there's an, according to Ziegler, and I think she's right, there's an active kind of demonization of these protective mothers who aren't loyal citizens. And there's some, I have a lot of quotes and stuff that I can't pull off the top of my head. So they're demonized at the time, and it really quiets down the most pacifist women. They sort of retreat. And the women's suffrage movement changes its course and says, we don't like war, but we are going to prove our patriotism. We are going to show that women can earn the vote. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Great, thank you. In the future?
Yeah.
It's sort of... that brings, you know, who's president. They did in World War II. It disappeared for the most part, I would argue. So I don't know. I think that it's a more complicated story now. And I don't think that would be particularly the image. But it could certainly be this sort of issues about the family writ large, not about just vulnerable women, but the notion that we have to protect the family, right, from danger. I think that might be a piece of the puzzle. It's an interesting question, thank you. Up in the corner and then over there. How was it received after the war, all this activist women? Well, women who were active during the war in reform and suffrage continue to be activists. They're involved in reforms and the like. But one of the things that I find that's really interesting is that after the war, the people who are interested in promoting the sort of grand history of the war, because not everybody was in the Lost Generation. There are a lot of people sort of promoting the wonderfulness of the United States effort. They were not objecting to the war, they were objecting to the peace. So in those groups, what they're doing is valorizing men, not women, except the mothers of soldiers. So they're back to being in favor again in that group. It's a really interesting question. It's sort of like a 5 or 6 page answer in my book, so I gave you the short version. But thank you. Yes?
Going back to Patria.
Yes. Yes. It's also Latin, so he's actually that's where he's pulling us from. It's not being saying anything nice about the Spanish. I mean, he was really pretty vile. So no, I don't think so. But the White House tried to ask him to tone it down because it was really interfering with their ability to work with Japan. In particular, and so in some of the images, apparently they go through and they kind of edit to try to make the enemy look less Japanese. But it's a pretty strange thing. It's that part's been really written about quite a bit. Yeah.
Did you find a lot of variance during your research, geographically within the states, or attitudes for femininity and diversity?
That's a really good question. Did I find a lot of variance in the states? I was trying to do too much to break it down, but I think if I had been doing that, I would have found it. And one of my quotes about a parade that was a conventional depiction was from a southern state, a white southern newspaper that was, very cloying about how cute the women looked in their uniforms, that kind of stuff. You know, they were adorable and weren't they sweet in their little hats. So you certainly, I think you could find it. California would be, as you might imagine, the left coast. And so it was really, there was a very strong, powerful female presence on the West Coast and a lot of support for women in that regard. Yes?
I want to go back to what she was asking about the war.
Yes?
And it doesn't have to be a war, because many hundreds of thousands of soldiers joined right after 9/11. And it was an attack, it wasn't a war, and yet she
That's a really good question. I mean, what is war now anyway? Right? Do we know? We don't. It's not the same as it used to be. And so as we don't have propaganda posters in the same kind of way, we have other kinds of propaganda. Thanks. That's an interesting question. Comment. I really enjoyed your questions. It was, and also very attentive faces, I could tell when I was speaking. That was, it's always encouraging. Thank you so much.